Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Serengeti Rules, The Quest to Discover How Life Works and Why It Matters, by Sean B. Carroll, narrated by Patrick Lawlor. Suppose it were perfectly certain that the life and fortune of every one of us would, one day or other, depend upon his winning or losing a game of chess. Don't you think that we should all consider it to be a primary duty to learn at least the names and the moves of the pieces? Yet it is a very plain and elementary truth that the life, the fortune, and the happiness of every one of us, and more or less of those who are connected with us, do depend upon our knowing something of the rules of a game infinitely more difficult and complicated than chess. It is a game which has been played for untold ages. The chessboard is the world. The pieces are the phenomena of the universe. The rules of the game are what we call the laws of nature. Thomas H. Huxley, A Liberal Education, 1868. Introduction. Miracles and Wonder. The corrugated gravel road, known officially as Tanzania Route B-144, provides a bone-jarring, teeth-rattling, bladder-testing connection between two of the great wonders of Africa. At its eastern end stand the massive green slopes of Ngorongoro Crater, a giant, more than 10-mile-wide caldera formed by the collapse of one of the many extinct volcanoes of the Great Rift Valley, and home to more than 25,000 large mammals. To the west lie the vast plains of the Serengeti, our destination on this cloudless, postcard-perfect day. The route in between is a stark contrast to the lush Ngorongoro Highlands. There is no visible source of water. The Maasai herdsmen and boys we pass in their bright red shuka graze their livestock on whatever brown stubble they can find. But as we bounce our way through the first simply marked gate to Serengeti National Park, the landscape changes. The Maasai vanish, and the nearly barren tracts they use are replaced by straw-colored grasslands. And instead of cattle and goats, sleek black-striped Thompson gazelles look up to see who or what is kicking up dust all over their breakfast. The anticipation in our Land Cruiser rises. Where there are gazelles, there may be other creatures lurking in the tall grass. We pop open the top of the vehicle, stand up, and with the African rhythms of Paul Simon's Graceland playing in my head, I start to scan back and forth. This is my first visit to what the Maasai call Serengit, for endless plains. Joining me on my pilgrimage to this legendary wildlife sanctuary is my family. Pilgrims with families, and we are going to Graceland. At first, I am a bit concerned. Where is all the wildlife? Yes, it is the dry season, but things look really dry. Can this place live up to its reputation? The continuous grass plain is broken only occasionally by small rocky hills or koppies. From their granite boulders, animals or tourists can scan around for miles. There are also gray or red termite mounds projecting up to a few feet over the tops of the grass. One's eye is naturally drawn to these shapes. "What is that over there?" asks a voice in the vehicle. A couple of us grab our binoculars and zero in on a lone mound a couple of hundred yards away. "Lion!" A golden lioness is standing on top, staring out over the surrounding grass. "Okay, so they are here," I murmur to myself. "But this is the famous Serengeti?" It is going to be really hard to spot things in this tall, dry grass. I am the only biologist in my clan. I can't expect anyone else to want to do this for days on end. As we drive on, some streaks of green grass appear, with a few iconic flat-topped acacia trees sprinkled about. A creek bed meanders through the green patches, and it has plenty of water. We go over a small rise, round a bend, and skid to a stop. Zebra and wildebeest block the road and fill the entire view. It is a sea of stripes. Perhaps 2,000 or more animals have gathered near a large waterhole, raising a ruckus. The zebra's calls are something between a bark and a laugh. Quaha! Quaha! While the wildebeest seem to just mutter, huh? These herds are stragglers from the greatest animal migration on the planet, when as many as 1 million wildebeest, 200,000 zebras, and tens of thousands of other animals follow the rains north to greener grazing grounds. Coming next to the waterhole from over the small rise on our left, the Dawn Patrol, a parade of elephants with several youngsters scurrying to keep up. The herds part to make way. From that point on, the Serengeti offers an unending canvas containing mammals of many sizes, shapes, and colors. Small gray warthogs with tails standing straight up like our radio antenna. Not two or three, but at least 9 species of antelope. The tiny dik-dik, the massive eland, impala, tope, waterbuck, hartebeest, Thompson's and the larger Grant's gazelles, and the ubiquitous wildebeest, black-backed jackals, towering Maasai giraffe, and yes, all 3 big cats on this first day, including several more lions, a leopard dozing in a tree, and a cheetah posing just feet from the road. Although I have seen many pictures and movies, nothing prepared me for, nor spoiled the thrill of, encountering this stunning scenery for the first time. A strange but very pleasant feeling sweeps over me as I gaze across a wide green valley with multitudes of creatures and acacia stretching as far as I can see, and the sun beginning to set behind the silhouettes of the surrounding foothills. Although it is the first time I have ever been to Tanzania, I feel at home. And indeed, this is home. For across the Rift Valley of East Africa lay buried the bones of my and your ancestors, and those of our ancestors' ancestors. Sandwiched between Ngorongoro Crater and the Serengeti lies Olduvai Gorge, a 30-mile-long twisting maze of badlands. It was in its eroding hillsides, just 3 miles off of the current B-144, that, after decades of searching, Mary and Louis Leakey and their sons unearthed not one, not two, but 3 different species of hominids that had lived in East Africa 1.5 to 1.8 million years ago. 30 miles to the south at Laetoli, Mary and her team later discovered 3.6 million-year-old footprints made by our small-brained but upright-walking ancestor, Australopithecus afarensis. Those hard-earned hominid bones were precious needles in a haystack of other animal fossils that tell us that, although the specific actors have changed, the drama we can still see today, of fleet herds of grazing animals trying to stay out of the reach of a number of wily predators, has been playing for thousands of millennia. Hordes of ancient stone tools found around Olduvai and butchery marks on those bones also tell us how our ancestors were not merely spectators, but very much a part of the action. Human life has changed immensely over the millennia, but never so much or so quickly as in the past century. For almost the entire 200,000-year existence of our species, Homo sapiens, biology controlled us. We gathered fruits, nuts, and plants, hunted and fished for the animals that were available, and like the wildebeest or zebra, we moved on when resources ran low. Even after the advent of farming and civilization and the development of cities, we were still very vulnerable to the whims of the weather and to famine and epidemics. But in just the past 100 years or so, we have turned the tables and taken control of biology. Smallpox, a virus that killed as many as 300 million people in the first part of the 20th century, far more than in all wars combined, has not merely been tamed, but has been eradicated from the planet. Tuberculosis, caused by a bacterium that infected 70 to 90% of all urban residents in the 19th century and killed perhaps 1 in 7 Americans, has nearly vanished from the developed world. More than 24 other vaccines now prevent diseases that once infected, crippled, or killed millions, including polio, measles, and pertussis. Deadly diseases that did not exist in the 19th century, such as HIV/AIDS, have been stopped in their tracks by designer drugs. Food production has been as radically transformed as medicine. While a Roman farmer would have recognized the implements on an American farm in 1900, the plow, hoe, harrow, and rake, he would not be able to fathom the revolution that subsequently transpired. In the course of just 100 years, an average yield of corn more than quadrupled from about 32 to 145 bushels per acre. Similar gains occurred for wheat, rice, peanuts, potatoes, and other crops. Driven by biology, with the advent of new crop varieties, new livestock breeds, insecticides, herbicides, antibiotics, hormones, fertilizers, and mechanization, the same amount of farmland now feeds a population that is 4 times larger, but that is accomplished by less than 2% of the national labor force, compared to more than 40% a century ago. The combined effects of the past century's advances in medicine and agriculture on human biology are enormous. The human population exploded from fewer than 2 billion to more than 7 billion people today. While it took 200,000 years for the human population to reach 1 billion in 1804, we are now adding another billion people every 12 to 14 years. And whereas American men and women born in 1900 had a life expectancy of about 46 and 48 years, respectively, those born in 2000 have expectancies of about 74 and 80 years. Compared to rates of change in nature, those greater than 50% increases in such a short time span are astounding. As Paul Simon put it so catchily, "These are the days of miracles." Rules and regulations. Our mastery, our control over plants, animals, and the human body comes from a still exploding understanding about the control of life at the molecular level. And the most critical thing we have learned about human life at the molecular level is that everything is regulated. What I mean by that sweeping statement is, every kind of molecule in the body, from enzymes and hormones to lipids, salts, and other chemicals, is maintained in a specific range. In the blood, for example, some molecules are 10 billion times more abundant than other substances. Every cell type in the body, red cells, white cells, skin cells, gut cells, and more than 200 other kinds of cells, is produced and maintained in certain numbers. And every process in the body, from cell multiplication to sugar metabolism, ovulation to sleep, is governed by a specific substance or set of substances. Diseases, it turns out, are mostly abnormalities of regulation, where too little or too much of something is made. For example, when the pancreas produces too little insulin, the result is diabetes. Or when the bloodstream contains too much bad cholesterol, the result can be atherosclerosis and heart attacks. And when cells escape the controls that normally limit their multiplication and number, cancer may form. To intervene in a disease, we need to know the rules of regulation. The task for molecular biologists, a general term I will use for anyone studying life at the molecular level, is to figure out, to borrow some sports terms, the players, molecules, involved in regulating a process and the rules that govern their play. Over the past 50 years or so, we have been learning the rules that govern the body's levels of many different hormones, blood sugar, cholesterol, neurochemicals, stomach acid, histamine, blood pressure, immunity to pathogens, the multiplication of various cell types, and much more. The Nobel Prizes in physiology or medicine have been dominated by the many discoverers of the players and rules of regulation. Pharmacy shelves are now stocked with the practical fruit of this knowledge. Armed with a molecular understanding of regulation, a plethora of medicines has been developed to restore levels of critical molecules or cell types back to normal, healthy ranges. Indeed, the majority of the top 50 pharmaceutical products in the world, which altogether accounted for $187 billion in sales in 2013, owe their existence directly to the revolution in molecular biology. The tribe of molecular biologists, my tribe, is justifiably proud of their collective contributions to the quantity and quality of human life. And dramatic advances in deciphering information from human genomes are ushering in a new wave of medical breakthroughs by enabling the design of more specific and potent drugs. The revolution in understanding the rules that regulate our biology will continue. One aim of this book is to look back at how that revolution unfolded and to gaze ahead to where it is now heading. But the molecular realm is not the only domain of life with rules, nor the only branch of biology to have undergone a transformation over the past half century. Biology's quest is to understand the rules that regulate life on every scale. A parallel but less conspicuous revolution has been unfolding as a different tribe of biologists has discovered rules that govern nature on much larger scales. And these rules may have as much or more to do with our future welfare than all the molecular rules we may ever discover. The Serengeti Rules. This second revolution began to flower when a few biologists began asking some simple, seemingly naive questions. Why is the planet green? Why don't the animals eat all the food? And what happens when certain animals are removed from a place? These questions led to the discovery that, just as there are molecular rules that regulate the numbers of different kinds of molecules and cells in the body, there are ecological rules that regulate the numbers and kinds of animals and plants in a given place. I will call these ecological rules the Serengeti Rules, because that is one place where they have been well documented through valiant, long-term studies, and because they determine, for example, how many lions or elephants live on an African savanna. They also help us understand, for example, what happens when lions disappear from their ranges. But these rules apply much more widely than to the Serengeti, as they have been observed at work around the world and shown to operate in oceans and lakes as well as on land. I could just as easily call these the Lake Erie Rules, but that just seems to lack a sense of majesty. These rules are both surprising and profound. Surprising because they explain connections among creatures that are not obvious. Profound because these rules determine nature's ability to produce the animals, plants, trees, and clean air and water on which we depend. However, in contrast to the considerable care and expense we undertake in applying the molecular rules of human biology to medicine, we have done a very poor job in considering and applying these Serengeti rules in human affairs. Before any drug is approved for human use, it must go through a series of rigorous clinical tests of its efficacy and safety. In addition to measuring a drug's ability to treat a medical condition, these studies monitor whether a drug may cause problematic side effects by interfering with other substances in the body or the regulation of other processes. The criteria for approval pose a high barrier. About 85% of candidate medicines fail clinical testing. That high rejection rate reflects, in part, a low tolerance on the part of doctors, patients, companies, and regulatory agencies for side effects that often accompany drugs. But for most of the 20th century and across much of the planet, humans have hunted, fished, farmed, forested, and burned whatever and settled wherever we pleased, with no or very little understanding or consideration of the side effects of altering the populations of various species or disturbing their habitats. As our population boomed to 7 billion, the side effects of our success are making disturbing headlines. For example, the number of lions in the world has plummeted from about 450,000 just 50 years ago to 30,000 today. The king of the beasts that once roamed all of Africa, as well as the Indian subcontinent, has disappeared from 26 countries. Tanzania now holds 40% of all of Africa's lions, with one of their largest remaining strongholds in the Serengeti. There are similar stories in the oceans. Sharks have prowled the seas for more than 400 million years, but in just the past 50 years, populations of many species around the world have plunged by 90 to 99%. Now, 26% of all sharks, including the great hammerhead and whale shark, are at risk of extinction. Some might say, so what? We win, they lose. That is how nature works. But that is not how nature works. Just as human health suffers when the level of some critical component is too low or too high, we now understand from the Serengeti rules how and why entire ecosystems can get sick when the populations of certain members are too low or too high. There is mounting evidence that global ecosystems are sick, or at least very tired. One measure that ecologists have developed is the total ecological footprint of human activity from growing crops for food and materials, grazing animals, harvesting timber, fishing, infrastructure for housing and power, and burning fuels. Those figures can then be compared with the total production capacity of the planet. The result is one of the most simple but telling graphs I have encountered in the scientific literature. 50 years ago, when the human population was about 3 billion, we were using about 70% of the Earth's annual capacity each year. That broke 100% by 1980 and stands at about 150% now, meaning that we need 1.5 Earths to regenerate what we use in a year. As the authors of this now annual study note, we have a total of just one Earth available. We have taken control of biology, but not of ourselves. Rules to live by. As biased as it sounds coming from a biologist, the impact of biology over the past century demonstrates that among all the natural sciences, biology is central to human affairs. There can be no doubt that in facing the challenges of providing food, medicine, water, energy, shelter, and livelihoods to a growing population, biology has a central role to play for the foreseeable future. Every ecologically knowledgeable biologist I know is deeply concerned about the declining health of the planet and its ability to continue to provide what we need, let alone to support other creatures. Wouldn't it be terribly ironic if, while we race toward and discover more cures to all sorts of molecular and microscopic threats to human life, we continue to just sail on blissfully or willfully ignorant of the state of our common home and the greater threat from disregarding how life works on the larger scale? No doubt most passengers on the Titanic were also more concerned about the dinner menu than the speed and latitude at which they were steaming. So, for our sake, Let's know all the rules, not just those that pertain to our bodies. Only through wider understanding and application of these ecological rules will we control and have a chance to reverse the side effects we are causing across the globe. But my goals in this book are to offer much more than some rules, however practical and urgent they are. These rules are the hard-earned rewards of the long and still ongoing quest to understand how life works. One of my aims here is to bring that quest to life, as well as the pleasures that come from discovery. My premise is that science is far more enjoyable, understandable, and memorable when we follow scientists all over the world and into the lab and share their struggles and triumphs. This book is composed entirely of the stories of people who tackled great mysteries and challenges and accomplished extraordinary things. As for what they discovered, there is more to gain here than just better operators' manuals for bodies or ecosystems. One of the beliefs that many people have about biology, no doubt the fault of biologists and biology exams, is that understanding life requires command of enormous numbers of facts. Life appears to present, as one biologist put it, a near infinitude of particulars which have to be sorted out case by case. Another of my aims here is to show that is not the case. When we ponder the workings of the human body, or the scene I encountered on the Serengeti, the details would seem overwhelming, the parts too numerous, and their interactions too complex. The power of the small number of general rules that I will describe is their ability to reduce complex phenomena to a simpler logic of life. That logic explains, for example, how our cells or bodies know to increase or decrease the production of some substance. The same logic explains why a population of elephants on the savanna is increasing or decreasing. So even though the specific molecular and ecological rules differ, the overall logic is remarkably similar. I believe that understanding this logic greatly enhances one's appreciation for how life works at different levels, from molecules to humans, elephants to ecosystems. What I hope everyone will find here, then, is fresh insight and inspiration. Insight into the wonders of life at different scales. Inspiration from the stories of exceptional people who tackled great mysteries and had these brilliant insights, and a few whose extraordinary efforts have changed our world for the better. After 5 days in the Serengeti, we have seen all of the species of large mammals except one. As we drive back out through the straw-colored grasslands, as if on cue, a novel silhouette appears on the horizon with a prominent telltale horn. A black rhino. With just 31 rhinos remaining in the entire Serengeti, it is a rare and thrilling sight. But knowing that there was once more than 1,000 of the animals here, it is also a sober reminder of the challenges ahead. Although, thanks to knowing the molecular rules of human erections, we now have at least 5 different inexpensive pills that can do the job, rhino horns are still being poached for use as very expensive aphrodisiacs in the Orient. These are the days of miracle and wonder. And don't cry, baby, don't cry. Don't cry. Part 1. Everything is regulated. Chapter 1. The Wisdom of the Body. The living being is stable. It must be so in order not to be destroyed, dissolved, or disintegrated by the colossal forces, often adverse, which surround it. Charles Richer, Nobel Laureate, 1913. The snapping of tree limbs jostled me out of a deep sleep. Peering through the front screen of our large tent, perched on a wooded bluff over the Tarangire River in northern Tanzania, I could not see anything outside in the pitch-black, motionless night. Maybe the wind had toppled a tree? I checked the clock, 4 a.m., and rolled over, hoping to get a couple of more hours of rest. Then I heard heavy footsteps, crunching at first in front of the tent, then on all sides of us, accompanied by occasional low rumbling, almost purring noises. They were really close. My wife Jamie was now awake. A family of elephants had hiked up the slope from the riverbed to browse on the trees and shrubs on top. With no natural predators, the animals walked wherever they desired, and at 8,000 pounds or more, with strong forklift-like tusks, they simply bulldozed their way through any thicket. As we heard branches and trunks splinter, I wondered about the thin canvas that separated us. With utter disregard for the resting humans nearby and, thankfully, no interest in our rectangular refuges, they munched past dawn before heading back down the hill to drink. As daylight came, we stepped carefully outside to photograph one straggler. Boy, elephants look even bigger when there is nothing between you and them. This bull was huge, more than 10 feet tall at his shoulders, with giant ears. Stripping branches and leaves off of small trees, while ignoring the paparazzi peering around the corners of several tents, he seemed content. Until some noise from a tent spooked him. He trumpeted, pivoted to his left, and took some quick steps in our direction. There is more than one account of what happened next. In my version, we dashed for the nearest tent, barreled inside, and instantly closed the zipper behind us, because 4-ton elephants can't open zippers. We then just stood inside, trembling and muttering, trying to regain our composure. In the biological version of those few seconds, a remarkable number of things happened in my brain and body. Before my mind could even form the thought, "Mad elephant, run," a primitive part of my brain, the amygdala, was signaling danger to my hypothalamus. This almond-sized command center just above the amygdala promptly sent out electrical and chemical signals to key organs. Through nerves, it signaled the adrenal glands that sit on top of my kidneys to release norepinephrine and epinephrine, also known as adrenaline. These hormones then circulated quickly through the bloodstream to many organs, including my heart, causing it to beat faster, my lungs to open up airways and increase breathing rate, my skeletal muscles to increase their contraction, my liver to release stored sugar for a quick supply of energy, and smooth muscle cells throughout my body, causing blood vessels to constrict, skin hairs to stand on end, and blood to shunt away from the skin, intestine, and kidneys. The hypothalamus also sent a chemical signal, corticotropic releasing factor, CRF, to the nearby pituitary gland that triggered it to release a chemical called adrenocorticotropic hormone, ACTH, that traveled to another part of the adrenal gland and triggered the release of another chemical, cortisol, which increased blood pressure and blood flow to my muscles. All these physiological changes are part of what is known as the fight or flight response. Coined and described a century ago by Harvard physiologist Walter Cannon, these responses are aroused by both fear and rage and quickly prepare the body for conflict or escape. We opted for escape. Scaredy cats. Cannon first became interested in the body's response to fear while conducting pioneering studies on digestion. X-rays had just been discovered when Cannon was a medical student. A professor suggested that he try to use the new gadget to watch the mechanics of the process. In December 1896, Cannon and a fellow student successfully obtained their first images of a dog swallowing a pearl button. They soon experimented with other animals, including a chicken, a goose, a frog, and cats. One challenge to observing digestion was that soft tissues, such as the stomach and intestines, did not show up well on X-rays. Cannon found that feeding animals food mixed with bismuth salts made their digestive tracts visible because the element was opaque to the rays. He also explored the use of barium. It was too expensive at the time for research work, but was later adopted by radiologists and still is used in gastroenterology today. In a classic series of studies, Cannon was able to observe for the first time in living, healthy, non-anesthetized animals, as well as in people, how peristaltic contractions move food through the esophagus, stomach, and intestines. During the course of his experiments, Cannon noticed that when a cat became agitated, the contractions promptly stopped. He jotted in his notebook, "Noticed several times very distinctly, so absolutely no doubt, that when cat passed from quiet breathing into a rage with struggling, the movements stopped entirely. After about 1/2 minute, the movements started again." Cannon repeated the experiment again and again. Every time, the movements resumed once the animal calmed down. The second-year medical student now had another finding to his credit. In what would become the second classic paper of his budding career, he wrote, "It has long been common knowledge that violent emotions interfere with the digestive process, but that the gastric motor activities should manifest such extreme sensitiveness to nervous conditions is surprising." Cannon's knack for experiments soon derailed his plans to become a practicing physician. His talent, rigor, and work ethic so impressed the distinguished faculty of the Department of Physiology at Harvard that he was offered an instructorship on graduation. The nervous stomach. In his own laboratory, Cannon aimed to figure out how emotions affected digestion. He observed that emotional distress also ceased digestion in rabbits, dogs, and guinea pigs, and from the medical literature, that also seemed to be true of humans. The connection between emotions and digestion suggested some direct role of the nervous system in controlling the digestive organs. Cannon knew that all the outward signs of emotional stress, the pallor caused by the contraction of blood vessels, cold sweat, dry mouth, dilation of pupils, skin hair standing on end, occurred in structures that are supplied by smooth muscle and innervated by the so-called sympathetic nervous system. The sympathetic system comprises a series of neurons that originate from the thoracic lumbar region of the spinal cord and travel out to clusters of nerve cells called ganglia. From there, a second set of generally much longer neurons extend to and innervate target organs. Most of the body's organs and glands receive sympathetic input, including the skin, arteries and arterioles, the iris of the eyes, the heart, and the digestive organs. These same organs also receive input from nerves originating in the cranial or sacral parts of the spinal cord. To figure out what stopped the activity of the stomach and intestines under emotional stress, Cannon and his students conducted a series of simple but fundamental studies. One approach was to sever the nerves leading to the digestive organs. Cannon found that when the vagus nerve, originating in the cranial system, was severed, but the splanchnic nerve, part of the sympathetic system, was left intact, the inhibition of peristalsis could still be induced by fear. In contrast, when the splanchnic nerves were cut and the vagus remained intact, there was no response to fear. These results showed that the inhibition of peristalsis induced by emotion required the sympathetic splanchnic nerves. Cannon had noticed that the inhibition of gastric activity often long outlasted the presence of whatever provoked the response. This suggested to him that there might be a second mechanism beyond direct nervous impulses that might prolong the agitated state. It had been reported that adrenaline, a substance extracted from the central portion of the adrenal glands, when injected into the bloodstream, could produce some of the effects produced by stimulation of the sympathetic nervous system. Cannon wondered whether the adrenal glands might be involved in the body's response to fear and anger. To test this possibility, Cannon made use of the natural enmity between dogs and cats. He and a young physician, Daniel de la Paz, compared blood samples of cats taken before and after they had been exposed to the stress of barking dogs. They discovered that the blood of frightened cats contained a substance that, when applied to a small strip of isolated intestinal muscle, stopped it from contracting. This was the same effect observed when adrenaline was applied to the muscle strip. Epinephrine was one of the components of adrenaline produced by the adrenal glands. Cannon and his colleagues also found that epinephrine sped up heart rate, the release of sugar from the liver, and even blood clotting. These same effects were triggered by pain as well as by fear or anger. None of these effects occurred when the adrenal glands were removed or when the nerves leading to the adrenal glands were cut. Thus, the sympathetic nervous system and adrenal glands worked in concert to modulate other body organs in stressful conditions. Cannon suggested that the responses induced by epinephrine reflected the emergency function of the adrenal glands in preparation for fight or flight, or in response to pain. A firm adherent to Darwin's principle of natural selection, Cannon interpreted the roles of the adrenal system through that lens. The organism which can best muster its energies, can best call forth sugar to supply the laboring muscles, can best lessen fatigue, and best send blood to the parts essential in the run or fight of its life, is most likely to survive. Cannon's student, Philip Bard, subsequently demonstrated that the hypothalamus is the critical part of the brain for control of the so-called involuntary, autonomic functions of the nervous system, including digestion, heart rate, respiration, and the fight-or-flight response. Both this part of the brain and these emergency responses are ancient. This same set of responses helped our ancestors avoid lions and hyenas on the savanna, just as they help pedestrians to dodge taxis in New York today, or tourists to run from elephants. A scientist soldier. Cannon was an Ivy League, but not an ivory tower scientist. In 1916, 3 years into World War I, as the battlefield in Europe turned into a horrific stalemate that produced enormous casualties, it seemed increasingly likely that the United States might be drawn into the conflict. Cannon was asked to chair a special committee of physiologists to advise the government on ways to protect the lives of soldiers and civilians. He learned that one of the most serious problems in battlefield medicine was the development of shock in wounded soldiers. Cannon recognized some of the shock symptoms: rapid pulse, dilated pupils, heavy sweating, from those he had observed in his experimental studies of animals under stress. Wounded soldiers who exhibited these symptoms often went downhill quickly and died. "Are there not untried ways of treating it?" he asked a fellow physiologist. Cannon was so taken with the problem of shock that he began some animal experiments to see whether he could figure out ways to mitigate the syndrome. When the United States did finally enter World War I in April 1917, Cannon was 45 years old and the father of five, and could have easily been excused from service. Instead, he volunteered as a member of a Harvard hospital unit that was one of the first American medical teams to go to Europe. Cannon requested to serve in a shock ward near the front lines in northern France. Cannon said goodbye to his family in Boston, took a train to New York, and boarded the troop ship Saxonia, bound for England. The voyage overseas would take 11 days. To avoid detection by German submarines, the ship was blacked out at night, with all of its portholes closed. While ships usually have lights at both ends so as to avoid collisions, the Saxonia lit only its stern to help draw any torpedo off target. 8 days into the voyage, as the ship drew nearer to the English coast, the orders came to sleep in one's clothes. If hit, it was better to jump into the lifeboats fully dressed. As the ship hit choppy seas in rain and fog, Cannon was relieved. "Not a favorable condition, I should say, for good hunting," he wrote to his wife Cornelia. The appearance of a British destroyer escort further eased anxieties. After arriving safely in England, Cannon continued on to the first of several field hospitals. A wave of casualties soon arrived from a major British offensive. Although Cannon had not practiced any medicine since his graduation from medical school 17 years earlier, he asked to assist in the operating room, dressed wounds, and worked in the wards. Cannon then moved to a hospital nearer the front. He watched helplessly the heartbreaking rapid decline of scores of soldiers. Why the soldiers died was a mystery that Cannon and several other American and British physiologists were hell-bent to solve. One important clue to shock came from the then-novel approach of measuring...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.